Grace and peace be with you and also with you. Once again, as the season of Lent begins, we are summoned by a gracious and merciful God. We respond to God's steadfast love, calling us together in praise. Let us bow before the one who creates. We approach God in reverence and wonder, rejoicing in God's grace. Walk humbly before God in prayer, fasting and giving. We seek the one who upholds each of us with a willing spirit. Let us pray. Gracious God, we are constantly bombarded with many temptations throughout the day. When we give in to those temptations, where do we turn? Always to you with your never-ending grace. You teach, counsel, and guide us in how we should go. We rejoice in your unfailing love. Amen.
Good morning. Seated.
We are told in the Gospels that where two or three are gathered in the name of Jesus, that God's presence is with us, and we celebrate the power in coming together in person and through our live stream broadcast and through our televised delayed a week broadcast. In coming together in prayer and praise, powerful things can unfold, and we celebrate that you're here. We know that there's some guests here today, maybe visiting for the very first time, and we welcome you, and we are so glad that you were able to join us. And I mentioned praying for Bobby Brooks, and she's here in person, and we celebrate that. I'm glad that you're here. And so we have our Hey card, and this is a tool that we use. It's especially helpful for me, so if I don't know you that well, if you give us some contact information, it allows me to follow up and get to know you in a more meaningful way. So if you'll fill this out, we'll ask you to drop it in the offering plate when we take up the offering. Also, if you want to connect with us in a digital way, we have a QR code in our bulletin and on the back of the pew. And if you're worshiping with us virtually or through our broadcast, if you would go to our website and connect with us in that way. It really is helpful when you check in with the Hey card. Today we have a special guest who's going to share with us today. I want to introduce her to you. It's Brittany Cuevas, and she and her husband are here, Colby, visiting us all the way from Tupelo, Mississippi. And Brittany is with the Mississippi Methodist Senior Services Foundation. She is currently the Vice President of Philanthropy, after serving for 2 years as the Director of Accounting. But as the VP of Philanthropy, here's what she does. She's over all the planned giving. She's over all the endowed growth and grant writing, plus some. I like to call her the face, the beautiful face of Methodist Senior Services. More importantly, Brittany is deeply committed to serving and caring for older adults in the way and example of Jesus Christ. Her husband, Kobe, is right here. He was brave enough to sit near the front. Wish some of you were brave. Kobe is a pastor in his own right, and he's also a counselor. For 3 years in Tupelo, Mississippi, he has served as a counselor and as a marriage and family therapist, and we thank you for your service. Together, Kobe and Brittany have 3 children, Oliver and Evie, 8 years old, they're twins, and Caroline, age 3. They're down here eating seafood and taking a bit of a break while their children are being taken care of in Hattiesburg. But anyway, Brittany, you want to come and share what's on your heart.
It's so nice to come to the Deep South and people can pronounce and spell my last name, Cuevas. When you go north of Hattiesburg, nobody knows how to say it or spell it. So it is so good to be with you this morning. And I'm so thankful for Claire and the friendship that we have developed over the years. I've been pondering this phrase that I came across a few weeks ago called intergenerational electricity. I was reading a book by Parker Palmer, and it has stuck with me, and it really put words to what I experience on a daily basis when I visit residents that live on one of our Methodist Senior Services campuses, such as Seashore Highlands down here on the coast. But my first memories of intergenerational electricity happened with my grandmother. My grandmama Rose had Parkinson's, and she passed away after I had my twins. But she had Parkinson's my entire life, and it was very, very significant. And so when she would come stay at my parents' house, I would help take care of her, change her clothes, help her take a bath, all the things. But my favorite memory with my grandmama would be when, unfortunately, Parkinson's would make her freeze up sometimes and her feet wouldn't move, but she would be wanting to walk, and I would be holding her weight with my arms. And in those moments of caring for my grandmother, we could turn those hard moments into a dance party. And so we would just start to relax and loosen up and start to dance a bit. And grandmama would start to laugh, and I would start to encourage her. And in those moments, intergenerational electricity would happen. Like on the poles of a battery, where the young and the old connect, and the power that's released enlivens both parties, and it lights up the world. I've experienced intergenerational electricity with one of my dear friends that lives on one of our Tupelo campuses, Miss Dottie. She's 92 years old. And when Miss Dottie moved to Traceway, one thing that she feared the most was that she wouldn't have any young friends anymore. And then here I come along, someone who genuinely loves being with older people. And we've become friends. And one thing Miss Dottie does every day at 92 years old, she wakes up and she says, "Lord, what's your purpose for me today? Even at Traceway, I want to be used by you. I want to have a purpose, Lord." That enlivens my soul. Being friends with me and me coming in with spontaneity and variety enlivens her life. Intergenerational electricity. I wanted to thank you for being a church that is already looking for opportunities and creating opportunities for intergenerational electricity. This church serves Seashore Highlands in so many ways. You have board members here, volunteers here, some volunteers that go every single week to answer the phone, to have breakfast with elders, to be a face of love for them. You also have the beautiful ministry that your church provides, Home Under the Dome, where you have respite care for those that are experiencing memory loss, loving on their spouses or their loved ones that are taking care of them. So looking for opportunities for intergenerational electricity, you are a church that is doing that. Our mission at Methodist Senior Services is serving older adults in the spirit of Christian love, but we're doing that together. We're not an entity that's removed from the church. We were birthed out of the United Methodist Church over 60 years ago. And we're able to do things like offer the Sunday Fund, which is our benevolence fund. If we have a resident that has lived on one of our 12 campuses and they've outlived their resources, they can apply for Sunday Fund assistance. And Sunday Fund assistance will help cover the cost of them living on that campus and they can remain on that campus. So over 60 years, we've never turned away a resident because they can't afford to stay. And the only way we can do that is through your support, through the church, through donors, giving to the Sunday Fund. Last year alone, Over $500,000 was utilized for residents to stay on campuses through the Sunday Fund. And this church ranked fifth of all the churches in Mississippi, fifth in the top 20. So it's amazing. It's such a privilege to be a part of this ministry with you, to have you invested in serving older adults in the spirit of Christian love, looking for opportunities for intergenerational electricity, making sure that residents that are living on a campus like Seashore still have a sense of belonging and purpose, and even your congregants here, creating opportunities for that intergenerational electricity here under your church roof. May we never leave people behind and make them feel isolated or lonely. Three of the plagues that we have found that impact us as we age are loneliness, helplessness, and boredom. And when the church is alive and serving one another, we're fighting against those plagues, and we're giving people life and purpose and meaning. And I'm really grateful to be doing that with you. So thank you for serving. Thank you for investing in the Sunday Fund and Seashore Highlands. If you haven't visited Seashore Highlands down here on the coast, it's a beautiful campus. There's plenty of opportunities to serve, so please reach out. Just visit if you'd like to, make a friend. And also know that we're a resource to you. Even if you never live on one of our campuses or your family member does not live on our campus, maybe you just have questions. Maybe your parents are kind of going into that stage of life where they've got some decisions to make. Please don't hesitate just to reach out to us as a resource so that we can help you answer some questions you may have. So may we be God's church that is serving God's older kids in the spirit of Christian love, and realize that we're all in this together. It's good to be here, and thank you for having me.
We thank you, Brittany, and we thank you for all the great work you do for our state and for God's kingdom. And thank you to all the board members on the greater board, but also at Seashore Highlands. And Mother's Day is when we take up the Sunday Fund. And my hope is that we can, you know, get up to third instead of fifth. So we'll see if that happens. As we do every single week, we take up an offering and giving thanks to God for all that God has given us. So let's pray. Gracious God, generation after generation after generation, you remind us that what we give back comes back a thousandfold. So use these gifts to your glory and honor. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Please remain standing as we affirm our faith together in the risen Christ by reading and/or reciting the Apostles' Creed found in our bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning. Would you pray with me? Dear Lord, we just thank you for right now that we can come and worship you as a community and be under this beautiful roof that we have. And God, during this Lenten season, we ask that we seek you and that we seek you by learning about you, getting in your word, that we seek you with our service, whether that be in our community, our job, or this church. We seek you through prayer that we may spend time with you daily because we know you want that. And we seek you through our relationships because we know that you reside in all of us. And we ask that you be with this community, be with the leaders of this church, and let us pray as you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For God is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Amen.
Well, good morning, church. If you're able, please stand and let's sing together, Abide With Me.
Abide with me. Fast falls the eventide, the darkness deepens. Lord, with me abide. When other helpers fail and comfort flee, help of the helpless, abide with me. Now on my head in early youth did smile, and though rebellious and perverse meanwhile, thou hast not left me, though I oft left thee, unto the close. I need thy presence every passing hour, but thy grace can foil the tempter's power. Who like thyself mine guide and stay can be. Oh, God and sun, shine, abide with me. I fear no foe.
Good morning. The gospel reading this morning is from Mark, chapter 1, verses 9 through 15. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Special thanks to Owen Miller, who led such a heartfelt prayer. We thank you for that, Owen. And thank you, Susan McClellan, for reading for us The Temptation of Christ according to the Gospel of Mark, the first chapter. Well, let's get right to it, okay? Let's invite the Holy Spirit to inspire us. If you will, take a deep breath with me and just release anything that might be getting in the way of hearing God's word. Come, Holy Spirit, come in the way that only you can come and shine forth your wisdom and truth into our hearts and minds so that we may be inspired to go out into a hurting world and be your hope. And now may the words of my mouth, as well as the reflections and meditations of all our hearts, may they be acceptable, O God, in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. The first Sunday in Lent always takes us straight into the wilderness. And I'm not talking about a picnic on the beach or a well-manicured hiking trail kind of wilderness. I'm talking about a place where evil lurks, where wild beasts prowl, and where angels minister. Mark's gospel, the first chapter, wastes no time. Jesus is baptized by John in the River Jordan, and then the heavens are ripped apart, and then the Holy Spirit in the form of a dove falls upon Jesus, and God's voice from heaven says of Jesus, "You are my Son, the Beloved, my Blessed One. And with you, I am well pleased. I take great delight." And then immediately, without any warning, immediately the same Spirit that baptizes Jesus, this same Spirit drives Jesus into the wilderness. I mean, this is a relentless push, a relentless shove, if you will. I mean, Jesus barely has time to catch his breath. He's still wringing wet. He's drenched with Jordan River water. when he finds himself in the middle of nowhere in this dry bone desert, all alone, toe to toe with the devil. Well, welcome to the ministry, Jesus. A mentor of mine, long, long time ago, also a clergy person, when I was first starting out in ministry, said this to me. It's a quote that goes like this: ministry is a contact sport, and if you can't take a lick every now and then, you better get off the field. I don't know why. I have no idea why, but it tends to be true, if not universally true, that we grow. We stretch our souls in times of challenge and conflict and struggle. You can read all about it in this phenomenon in countless biographies and autobiographies about various people throughout history. In fiction, we call it the hero's journey. And this is when a person, a leader, a hero or heroine, doesn't matter the gender, but this person strikes out and goes through all this conflict and temptation and trial, and somehow, some way, comes out on the other side changed and transformed. This is the story, is it not, of ancient Israel, a story that Jesus would have known by heart. These Hebrew people, they enter into the Sea of Reeds, the Red Sea. They enter into those waters as slaves, and then they exit. They come out of those same waters as free men and women of God. But it takes them 40 years. Now, 40, we know in the Bible, means what? A long, long time. It takes them 40 years of up and down, of challenge and struggle and ordeal. It takes them that long to learn and to figure out how to be free people of God instead of slaves in Egypt. This story today of Jesus, found in these seven verses, I think that's 7, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, yeah. In these seven verses, three things happen in pretty rapid sequence. You could break it down or break it into a three-act play. Act one, Jesus is baptized. Act two, Jesus is tempted and tested in the wilderness. And then chapter three, Jesus begins his ministry, his saving work, his public ministry in the world. And it is the wilderness trial that ties the two together, Jesus' baptism and his saving work. And there's no getting around it. Reminds me of that children's song, that rhyme. It goes like this: we're going on a bear hunt. We're going to catch a big one. I'm not scared. What a beautiful day. Look, can't go over it. Can't go under it. Can't go around it. Gotta go what? Through it. This long season of Lent reminds us, you know this, before we can enter into the promised land, we have to first go through the wilderness. In our tradition, as people of faith, as Christians, we say it this way: we can't experience Easter without going through the what? Cross. And for Jesus to submit completely to his baptism and to God's saving work for him to do in the world, he had to go through what we call the crucible of fire. By the way, for the Lenten season 2024 here at First United Methodist Church in downtown Gulfport, our Lenten sermon series is called Wind and Fire, because we're going to be exploring the role of the Holy Spirit for these next 40 days working in and through us. But back to Jesus here. He goes through this crucible of fire because who he was, God's beloved, and what he's called to do, God's saving work in the world, it will come into full clarity and focus right here in the wilderness. Now, this story, this same story of Jesus spending 40 days in the desert, is told three times. Now, when a story is told three times in all four Gospels, we're supposed to pay attention, right? So Matthew tells it, Mark tells it, and Luke tells it. Now, the version that I struggle with the most is Mark's Gospel. Very rarely do I preach Mark's version of the temptation of Christ. And the reason for that is mainly because it's so short. It's so short, I can read to you in one slide the entire wilderness drama. It goes like this. And the Spirit immediately drove him, meaning Jesus, out into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness, how long? 40 days, tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. That's it. Two short verses. Matthew and Luke, they go on and on, and they go into precise detail about these three particular temptations. But Mark, about the temptations, hardly says anything at all. And you know what happens when we're left with a vacuum of information. You know what happens, don't you? We fill it in with our own worst and wildest fears. The wildest fear to me in this story has to do with those wild beasts. Because, you know, I don't like to be startled. If you've got something bad to tell me, you know, let me know well in advance and let me know it gently, please. Please, please, please. I like to tell this story. It's a personal story. And I almost didn't tell it today. I'll tell it usually on the first Sunday of Lent. I've been here, Brittany Colby, so long now that I'm telling the same stories over and over and over. So just indulge me if you've heard this story before. But many years ago, when I was turning 30, I felt like I needed some kind of coming of age rite of passage experience. And so what I did is I went on an outward bound 2-week desert backpacking course, traveled all the way to Moab, Utah, in the desert. Gorgeous area if you haven't ever been. And there we went on this hike, and we were 8 days in, and the instructor said to us, "You're all invited." As I can remember, there were about 8 of us on the course. And this instructor said, "You're all invited to participate in a 3-day or 72-hour solo experience." This is customary. It's part of the tradition of Outward Bound. And the way it works is they would divide us up. There was plenty of wilderness. And they would divide us up, and you would stay in one spot. And you couldn't see anybody or hear anybody. But the instructors for the 3 days, they're up above you. And every now and then, without you knowing it, they're checking in on you to make sure you're okay. So you're never, ever alone. I want to make that clear. Now, I've done this kind of thing many times since. But this was my first solo experience in the wilderness. And they gave us a minimum amount of food, and they told us, don't go hiking alone and don't wander off. Don't expel any energy. This is about an inner journey, not an outward. And don't say a word. Just experience the silence in nature for 72 hours. Now, as I was settling into this experience, what I remember shocking to me was the silence. And how quiet it was. Now, every now and then, you would hear or see an airplane going coast to coast. But it was so quiet that you could hear the wings of the birds flapping in the wind. As the sun on that first night began to set, and it was getting darker and darker, I snuggled into my sleeping bag, and it's a mummy bag, and I cinched the hood over my head and face because it gets cold at night in the desert. And the darker it got, it finally got so black I couldn't see my hand in front of my face. So I decided to close my eyes and go to sleep. And then suddenly, out of nowhere, I'm jerked awake. And I'm just so afraid. My heart is pounding so hard that I thought it was going to leap out of my chest. And I'm hearing something. And what I'm hearing is footsteps. And these are the kind of footsteps that mean to do you harm. And they're getting closer and closer and closer. And it felt like they were circling around me. And my heart was racing. I had sweat forming on sections of my face, and you would think that I would run, but I didn't. I froze, which I have read later happens to people when they're overwhelmed with fear. And I would come up with all kinds of tactics in my imaginations, how I would escape or how I would defend myself. And every time I came up with an idea, I just recoiled. I was frozen. So all I knew to do was to breathe and to wait. And of course, pray. And you know what happened? I had this simple, obvious discovery. Those footsteps weren't footsteps. They were my eyelashes sweeping against my nylon sleeping bag. Can't imagine the relief and the joy. I laughed and I cried myself back to sleep. You see, the gift and challenge of the wilderness is that it exposes us. It strips us of our work, our technology, all those things we turn to for protection on a daily basis. Things like our to-do lists and our projects and our rich foods and drink, our comforts and our luxuries. And make no mistake, these are all wonderful gifts. They are good things. And they make life more enjoyable and much more bearable. But for the season of Lent, the church invites us to grow and to stretch our souls. And we do that in this way. We live a little less protected. Now, I don't know what that looks like for you, choir. I don't know what that's going to look like for any of you. I'm still trying to figure it out for myself. But we, during Lent, we live a little less protected so that we can come face to face with our interior demons and chaos, that which needs to be healed by God and God alone. Richard Rohr, he talks extensively about this, and he says that we cannot heal, much less transform, that which we do not name, that which we do not acknowledge. And so he says this: if you and I, if we do not transform our pain, we will most assuredly transmit it. Usually to those closest to us, like our family, our neighbors and friends, our coworkers, and invariably, get this, those who are most vulnerable, our children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. We shouldn't try, he writes, to get rid of our own pain until we have learned what it has to teach us. When we can hold our pain consciously and trustfully and not project it elsewhere, like in politics. He doesn't say that, I added it. When we can do that, we find ourselves open to learning and breaking through to a much deeper level of faith and consciousness. He does write this: please trust me on this, he writes. We must all carry the cross of our own reality until God transforms us through it. I've come to believe, with the help of others, people like Henry Nouwen, Richard Rohr, and many, many others, when Jesus invites his disciples then and today to take up your cross and follow me, I think this is what he means. You see, Jesus doesn't hoard power, he shares it. So Jesus invites us to share in his baptism. Jesus invites us to share in God's saving work. And the wilderness, that crucible of fire, ties the two together. But the real promise of the gospel is that God does not lead us where God's grace does not sustain us. Which leads me in Mark's gospel to talk about the angels. We talked about the wild beasts. In closing, let me touch on these angels. We're told in Mark's gospel that the angels waited on him. And what that means is they ministered to Jesus. They cared for him. Something like this will happen again in Luke's gospel, closer to the cross. Jesus will have just celebrated that Last Supper with his disciples when he makes his way again out of doors, outside, this time in the Mount of Olives. And the disciples, they're going to follow him. And yet we are told that Jesus is going to withdraw, we're told, a stone's throw away, which means they're kind of close by. Where is he withdrawing to? Within himself. Jesus withdraws within, and then we are told he knelt and he prayed, and here's what he prayed to God. Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Don't you see here the inner turmoil? Jesus is struggling. He's fighting the greatest battle of his life. He's torn. And then he finally says this to the Father. But not my will, but yours be done. And at that moment, we are told that an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. Friends, dear, dear people of faith, the struggle is real, but so is the victory. In and through our Lord Jesus Christ, so be it and so it is. Amen. We're going to invite you to sing a song. It's sort of new, but you've sung it before, and it's about the goodness of God. It's called Always Good. And as we're singing, if you're looking for a faith community to belong to, we're not perfect around here, but we do seek to love God and neighbor in the way and the manner of Jesus Christ. You can't be a Christian alone. You need the Holy Spirit. You need that wind and fire. But you also need community. So if that's resonating with you, we invite you to come forward as we sing together. Will you stand?
Let's stand. You meet me on the mountaintop. You see me in the valley low. There is no home without you here. And I find you in the crowded thoughts. You quiet all the question marks. There is no space your love won't fill. I'll trade all my fear for peace of mind. All my heaviness for burden light, and all will be my song. You are always good. I sing all day long. You are I set my eyes on perfect faith. You finish what you start in me. My heart will be an offering. I'll trade all my fear for peace of mind. All my heaviness for burden light. This will be my back to me. Every melody you're singing back to me, you're singing back to me. Every melody you're singing back to me, you're singing back. I traded all my fear for peace of mind. You took heaviness, my burden light, and this will be my song. You are always good. I'll sing it all day long. You are always good. And when the day is through, I am left with you.
Remember, friends, that life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel the way with us. So be swift to love, make haste to be kind, and may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all.